Good morning and welcome to worship. We're so glad that you're here joining us today. Today in our service, we take time to observe Remembrance Day. So in a few moments, we will have that liturgy. This morning at 10:30, the church school gathers online on Tuesday afternoon. Prayer shawl meets over Zoom at 2 p.m. And in the evening on Tuesday, finance and stewardship meets also by Zoom. I believe those are our announcements for this morning. We light the Christ candle to remember that always we worship in the presence of Jesus. Let us join together in our call to worship. On this day of memories, we gather to sing and pray, remembering the past and looking forward to the future. On this day when the guns and cannons fell silent, we come before you, God, seeking your peace. On this day of hope, we come before you, God, believing in your promise. Let us offer our worship.
Please be seated. Let us come before the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Eternal God, you forget nothing. All the days and events which have been lived were done so under your ever-loving eye. You have journeyed with us and with those who have gone before us. And so while we must take the time to consciously remember, you do so without forgetting a moment that has been. We give thanks this day for your faithfulness to your people in every land and age, for your presence with them in the dark days they have faced. And we come to praise you, that no matter what challenge lies before us, you have promised to be with us. Hear our silent prayer now. God of mercy, we confess that the world around us is in a mess. Countries turn arguments over territory into threats of terror. Old enemies stir up conflict. The threat of violence keeps us on edge. Forgive us for not learning from past conflicts what leads to peace with justice. Forgive us when we want to settle our own disagreements by keeping conflict alive. Forgive us and show us ways to transform our lives and our world. Hear our silent prayer now. All these things, loving God, we pray in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Christ died so that we might live. Through his undying love, we have been forgiven. Rejoice in the forgiveness that God offers to us. Be at peace with God and yourself, and make peace with your neighbors for the sake of Christ. Amen.
Year in so many ways. We are doing many things again in new and creative ways, and in some cases with a great deal more thought and planning. But even though this is a different year again, this is still a day that we pause and take time to remember those who served in conflicts. Even though we try to do things differently from the past, we will take time to remember. In Flanders fields, the poppies blow between the crosses row on row that mark our place, and in the sky, the larks still bravely singing fly, scarce heard amid the guns below. We are the dead short days ago. We lived, felt dawn, saw sunset glow, loved and were loved, and now we lie in Flanders fields. Take up our quarrel with the foe. To you from failing hands we throw the torch. be yours to hold it high. If ye break faith with us who die, we shall not sleep, though poppies grow in Flanders fields.
Let us remember the kindness of God and God's favor to us in our time of need. Let us remember the courage, devotion to duty, and the self-sacrifice of those who serve and have served in armed forces, and the toil, endurance, and suffering of those who were not in uniform. Let us remember those who were wounded in the fight, those who perished in air raids, those who fell in battle, and those who are buried at sea or in some corner of a foreign land. And especially those whom we have known and loved, whose place is forever in our hearts. Let us remember those who were our enemies, whose homes and hearts are as bereft as our own. Let us remember those who came back, those whose lives bear the scars of war. Let us remember the continuing grace of God, whose love holds all souls in life, and to whom none is dead, but all are alive forever. And now the tryst. They shall not grow old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the year condemn. At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember them.
Day in military camps during the war. This was known as the last post and was also sounded for those who had died. In a moment, we will hear last post played on the trumpet, followed by a time of silence as we remember those who have died in conflict.
Thank you.
Let us pray. In memory of those who died, Lord, may we be better people. And in gratitude to you, O Lord, may we live as those who are not our own, but have been bought with a price. Amen. And may the peace of Christ be with you. Let us share the peace of Christ. The children's story, which always seems like a jarring transition on a Sunday like this. We almost need a moment after. But thank you. Thank you to Linda for laying the wreath today. And thank you to Susan Guido and to Peter Fleming for sharing their music again this year, to Karen Mark and to Ruth Bennett for making it possible to share those audio files today. Thank you for helping us remember. Our children's story today is taken from the Gospel of Mark, our Bible reading today, and it is from Woodlake Books Story Bible. Thank you to Woodlake for allowing us to read from Ralph Milton's Story Bible today. And this is The Poor Woman's Gift. "Look at me," said the rich man. "See how much money I'm giving to God." The man put a big bag full of gold coins into the box. Jesus and his friends were watching. They were sitting in the temple where there were boxes for people to put money into. The money was to pay for things in the temple, such as fixing the walls or buying food for the people who worked there. Giving money to the temple was like giving money to the church. Jesus was glad people gave money to the temple, but Jesus didn't like the way some people bragged about how much they gave. "I'm giving even more money than that," said another rich man, as he put a bigger bag of money into the box. Jesus just shook his head. He was sad. Then a very poor woman came by, a woman who didn't have any family. All she had were two tiny little coins. When she thought no one was looking, she put them into the money box. "Look," Jesus said to his friends, "she gave the biggest gift of all." "But all she put in were two tiny coins," his friends said. "It was easy for rich people to put in those big bags of money," said Jesus, "because they have more money at home. It was very hard for the woman who gave two small coins. But when those rich men go home tonight, they'll still have food to eat. But the poor woman won't have as much to eat because she gave her money to God. She gave all she had." Amen. So I wonder why Jesus was sad. I wonder why the woman gave all she had. I wonder how the story speaks to you. Let us pray. Loving God, we give thanks for your many good blessings to us. Help us to be generous and share them. Help us, God, to share your love with those in the world, with those in our community, and with those further away. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
God blesses us that we might carry that blessing into the world, let us therefore give with grateful hearts. And now we'll hear some special music. Let us pray. Generous and gracious God, we have received so much from you in Christ and in creation. Bless the gifts we offer this day so that they will speak of your love for the world in all its detail and for people in all our diversity. May our gifts touch the need around us in the name of Christ, who makes us all one. Amen. And now we will sing in the hymn, O God, our help in ages past. Please be seated. Before continuing on with the prayer for illumination, there's one more word of thanks I'd like to give. We have someone who is very creative in our midst. She knows who she is. Lisa, thank you so much for making those poppies that adorn our church property. Thank you. Very well done. Let us pray. God, through the power of your Holy Spirit, open us to your word that we would hear what you would say to us today. In Jesus' name, amen. Our scripture reading today is taken from Mark chapter 12, verses 38 to 44. It's interesting. This is a real contrast. First of all, Jesus talking about the scribes and their nature, and then turning it around and talking about the widow. Let's attend then to God's word. Jesus warns against the teachers of the law. A large crowd was listening to Jesus gladly. As he taught them, he said, "Watch out for the teachers of the law, who like to walk around in their long robes and be greeted with respect in the marketplace, who choose the reserved seats in the synagogues and the best places at feasts. They take advantage of widows and rob them of their homes, and then make a show of saying long prayers. Their punishment will be all the worse." The widow's offering. As Jesus sat near the temple treasury, he watched the people as they dropped in their money. Many rich men dropped in a lot of money. Then a poor widow came along and dropped in two little copper coins worth about a penny. He called his disciples together and said to them, "I tell you that this poor widow put more in the offering box than all the others. For the others put in what they had to spare of their riches, but she, poor as she is, put in all she had. She gave all she had to live on." This is the word of the Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of God's Holy Spirit. Amen. A few weeks ago, we heard Jesus reminding us to deny ourselves and to bear our crosses, to put Jesus first in all things, to set ourselves apart from the world. This is sound advice on how to abide in his word and in this world. As our teacher, Jesus always shows us the right way to behave, how to conduct ourselves as his followers. Today's reading in Mark's gospel provides a warning that we are not to follow the hypocrisy and shallowness of the scribes, but to learn from the genuine faith of a poor widow. Then Jesus goes on to teach us to give ourselves wholeheartedly to God, as the widow does. First, though, a word about the scribes. Who were they, and what was their function? The scribes were the teachers of the religious law and had an insatiable appetite for greatness. They needed people to show them respect as they paraded about in the temple and the streets. Unlike Ezra of old, prominence and honor were what they were after, regardless of what they were doing, the role of a notary public or a court secretary. They did have this very important function, though. Were it not for these interpreters and clerks, there would have been no recording of the biblical canon as we know it. Unfortunately, these same scribes used their hypocrisy for personal gain. Jesus said that they took advantage of widows and robbed them of their homes, and then made a show of saying long prayers. The longer the prayer, the more money they made. Now, by contrast, take a look at the poor and humble widow. In her deep and abiding faith, she modeled complete trust and conviction in God. In her own way and by her meager means, this selfless widow offered all her resources to God, a testament to her total confidence in God's wisdom and will for her life. With such a journey of faith as hers, there was no need for her to worry about the trials of tomorrow. So Jesus calls you and me to look at this woman. Who was she, this poor, humble widow? And why does her story matter? It matters because Jesus was watching the pilgrims as they dropped their contributions into collection boxes for public charity. Can you picture this? Jesus was looking to see how each person put their gift in. But more importantly, Jesus was carefully scrutinizing the specific way that people gave their offerings to God. Oh, it was wonderful to see many blessed people being so charitable, not only giving, but giving generously. Jesus, though, was more concerned with how they gave. Did they give freely with joy, or did they offer sparingly, begrudgingly, and only offer what was left over? Jesus was observing the human heart. He was identifying what motivated people to reach out and to give. Did they give for the Lord and for the sake of others, or did they only give that their act might be seen by others? Within this crowd of wealthy and well-to-do people, a woman came and she caught Jesus' attention. She was widowed many years before, and she had no source of income that we know of. She was very poor, but she brought all her fortune with her, no more than 2 wee mites, the smallest of coins, less than a penny. She put them in the collection box as her offering to God. Now, we might be inclined to think the widow should have kept at least one of the coins for herself. Today's high finance way of thinking would surely say that this woman's offering was just a drop in the bucket compared to what others were giving. But according to Jesus, she was the one who had given the most. He said that her tiny contribution was greater than all the others, for the others had thrown in what they could spare easily enough and still have plenty left over, while the widow had flung in everything she had. He called his disciples together and said to them, "I tell you that this poor widow put more in the offering box than all the others." Now, all the others were contributing, yes, but they were giving a piece, a fraction, a remnant of what they had to give. As for the widow, free from limitation, she was willingly and eagerly giving everything she had. This is sacrificial giving, a gift from the servant's heart. And today, on this Remembrance Day, this Remembrance Sunday, as we commemorate the members of the Canadian Armed Forces who died in the line of duty, we think of another type of servant's heart, another example of sacrificial giving. Today we remember all those civilians and military people who, for the sake of our freedom, gave their lives in armed conflict. Today, we also recall the hope for peace after the end of bloody hostilities and merciless battles. We have in our thoughts those who laid down their lives in order that we can enjoy the freedoms we have. And we pray that their gift and sacrifice would not be in vain, that their service will long be remembered for the selfless act it was for the benefit of others, you and me. Fortunately, few of us will ever know the socioeconomic conflict that took these brave men and women from us. Few of us will ever know the living conditions of the widow who gave the very last of her resources. Whether we live in a war-ravaged environment or one that knows poverty and oppression, there are so many ways to feel poor, powerless, and helpless. We may be deprived of assets as we journey through life. We may be deprived of good health. We may be deprived of family support or friendship and feel so lonely and abandoned. We may be deprived of strength and of courage. Then we may think that because of all these trials in life, we are undervalued by others. But Jesus calls to us to come unto him as we are, in our weakness, with our poverty, imperfect as we are. Jesus calls us and assures us, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness." By the example of this poor woman and her way of giving, Jesus alludes to himself in the total self-giving of his suffering and death. Paul said to the church at Corinth, "For you know the generous act of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that by his poverty you may become rich." Through the gift of Jesus Christ, God's abundant grace has blessed us beyond what we deserve. For as Jesus said, "He came that we may have life and have it abundantly." So, what is the takeaway from all of this? First, says William Barclay, real giving must be sacrificial. The amount of the gift never matters so much as its cost to the giver. Not the size of the gift, but the sacrifice. Now think on this for a moment. To use the colloquial expression, real generosity gives until it hurts. Ask someone who has served or is serving in the Canadian Armed Forces, and they will understand what this means. For many of us, though, it is a real question if ever our giving to God's work is really a sacrifice. In springtime, we often hear the expression to give something up for Lent. This form of sacrificial giving is to reflect on how blessed we really are to do without some meaningful pleasure and consider how we might give a little more to God's work. It may well be a sign of decadence of the church in our time and the failure of Christianity in this age, Barclay opines, that gifts have to be coaxed out of, yes, even church people, and that often they will not give it all unless they get something in return. Real giving has to have a recklessness in it. The woman might have kept even one coin for herself. Who could blame her? But she didn't. There's great symbolism here. What does it mean that she held nothing back? For us, it means we should ask ourselves what we might be holding back. Is there some part of our daily living, some part of our routine activities, some part of our wealth, even some part of our very selves that we are not giving wholeheartedly to Christ? There is nearly always something that we hold back. We rarely make the final sacrifice and the final surrender, do we? It is both a strange and lovely thing that real giving is seen today in the person whom Jesus displays for us as a pattern of generosity, a person who gave a gift of less than one penny, and yet all she had. We may feel that we don't have much in the way of material or personal gifts to give to Christ, but if we put all that we have and are at Christ's disposal, he can do things that are beyond our imagining. I'll leave you with this to think on today. The story of the widow in Mark's gospel is really about poverty and oppression, isn't it? The scribes took advantage of the widow, robbing her of her resources, and yet here she is giving her proverbial life for public charity, really giving her life for someone else. Lest we forget. Please pray with me. God of each life and all lives, in every generation you have been present with your people. In times of poverty and prosperity, in times of sorrow and joy, in times of health, and in this time of pandemic, in times of war and peace. Today we remember your gracious care in times of crisis and give thanks for the courage and sacrifice of the women, men, and families of the Canadian Armed Forces who have worked for peace, justice, and protection in so many different times and places. Support those who have finished their time of service and face challenges in civilian life. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of promise and peace, we thank you for the places where conflicts have ended. Peace has been restored and where people can enjoy secure freedoms and human rights. Where people are oppressed and dissent restricted, encourage those who witness and work for justice to be established. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of wholeness and hope, we thank you for those called to serve others in their home communities, wherever they call home. Especially we give thanks for those in our communities working hard in the face of COVID-19. Give them courage. Give them strength. Keep them safe. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of commitment and courage, we thank you for the many organizations in Canada working to bring hope to people facing social exclusion, discrimination, or exploitation. Inspire leaders in our communities to provide access to the support they need to thrive. May all your beloved children enjoy the life you desire for them. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of Christ in community, we thank you for the dedication of those who serve in the church, offering so generously their gifts, their time, their talents. May your church always be a place of hope, healing, and welcome. Guide our congregation and denomination through these challenging times. Help us find ways to stay connected as your people, offering our worship, serving you in new and creative ways, and supporting each other through this time. Merciful God, hear our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. May I ask the congregation to rise. And now, friends, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of God's Holy Spirit be with you now and until the end of the age. Amen. And we will close the hymn, the service today, singing our national anthem, O Canada. Send a blessing to you for today, for the remainder of today, for the week ahead. May the peace of Christ be with you. Bye for now.